September is still 7 months away, but after Monmouth took a big step forward last year in the Big South in 2015, 2016 can't come soon enough. Today, a new batch of Hawks are welcomed into the nest as continuing coverage of National Signing Day rolls on from West Long Branch, New Jersey, next on ESPN. What a feeling here today. So much excitement surrounding all of the coverage on our ESPN family of networks. It is National Signing Day for college football. Alongside my partner, Eddie Iacopinti, I'm Matt Harmon. We are fortunate enough to bring you Monmouth University football during the course of the fall. But here in the smack dab middle of winter, Eddie, excitement certainly is the name of the game here today. 17 brand new players signing their national letter of intent.
Matt, around the country, high school athletes are committing to their college of choice for the next year. National Signing Day has become such a huge event on the college football calendar. Monmouth University very happy to be a part of it. Such an exciting day when you welcome in all these new players to a program that is trending upward.
We'll have obviously full coverage of all 17 players, including 10 from the state of New Jersey. We'll talk about positions and the breakdown, how it affects the incoming class and what it will do to the Monmouth University football program, a team that went 5-6 a season ago, 3-3 within the league. Right now, however, let's send it to the podium as head coach Kevin Callahan will introduce the brand new batch of Hawks.
Thank you, Greg, and I too want to welcome everybody here for the 2016 Signing Day celebration and our announcement of our 2016 recruiting class. Before I begin with that, however, I'd like to welcome the members of the media from the Asbury Park Press and the Shore Sports Network. I'd also like to extend a warm welcome to Dr. Marilyn McNeil, our Director of Athletics, and all the administrators here at Monmouth University. Before I begin with the class, announcing our class, I'd like to thank a number of people here that have really helped us with the recruiting effort this year. You know, first and foremost, we had a tremendous assistance from the faculty here at Monmouth University. When prospects visited our campus, they spent a number of hours visiting with them and talking about the academic programs here. The Office of Admissions and Financial Aid was also extremely instrumental in our recruitment effort. And certainly all the members of the athletics administration, from finance, marketing, the front office, the sports medicine department, and the strength and conditioning department, all did a tremendous job in assisting with this year's recruiting effort. And I also would like to thank the Office of Compliance, Student Athlete Development, for all of their work regarding eligibility, compliance, and making sure that all the proper paperwork was completed in bringing this class in. And last but not least, the Office of Athletic Communications, Greg Viscomi and Gary Colwall, for all of their efforts in putting this day and this celebration together. This is our third recruiting class as a member of the Big South, and as a coaching staff, we're extremely excited about this class that I'm about to introduce. I want to applaud the efforts of our coaching staff, you know, for bringing this class together. You know, Brian Gabriel, our recruiting coordinator, did a tremendous job of pulling this all together. But our staff worked extremely hard to uncover, I think, a very talented, very athletic, very academic group of prospects that signed with us. And I just want to applaud them for their diligence throughout this entire process. As you'll notice on the sheets that were handed out, this class comes from four states. There's 10 of the 17 from the state of New Jersey. We have four from the state of Maryland, two from New York, and one from Pennsylvania. And if you look at a positional breakdown, we have six offensive linemen in this class, two receivers, one quarterback, two defensive linemen, three linebackers, two defensive backs, and one specialist. Overall, you've got nine on offense, seven on defense, and one in special teams. At this time, I'd like to go through the players in this class individually and make a few comments on each of them. First is Wendell Allen, a quarterback from South Brunswick High School in New Jersey. And Wendell is a very tall, long, athletic player. He's got excellent cover skills. He's showed the ability to accelerate with tremendous speed. He can redirect. He can really go play the ball in the air. And we're excited to have a player of his size coming into the defensive secondary. Next is Bryce Barneys, Bryce is a receiver from Colonial High School here in New Jersey. Bryce is an athlete with good size, speed. He's very, very smooth in and out of his breaks. He's got the ability to run after the catch, and he's showed the ability to accelerate and run away from defenders, and we feel he's going to give us a big play threat at the receiver position. Jonathan Bryce is a safety from Archbishop Curley High School in Maryland, and at 6'1", he brings good size for a defensive back. He's a very physical player with good speed and acceleration, showed excellent range when we watched him on film. He's a very talented basketball player as well, and he really has the ability to play the ball and judge the ball in the air. Cameron Brown is one of our 6 offensive linemen from Simon Gratz High School down in Philadelphia. He's a strong physical player. We project him as an interior offensive lineman in the guard or center position. He's got very quick feet, good bend, and extremely good balance. Emmanuel Christian is the 2nd of the offensive linemen from this group, and Emmanuel comes from Newark Central High School up in Newark, New Jersey. As you can see, he's got very, very good size. He's very athletic. We love the aggressive mentality that he plays with. He was a very good defensive player as well in high school, and we're projecting Emmanuel as an offensive tackle. Daquan Grimes is one of the 3 linebackers in this class, and Daquan comes from Damascus High School down in Maryland. Daquan committed to us in the summer after spending some time with us at our summer camp. He's the latest in a long line of players from Damascus High School. I think he becomes our 5th player to come to the Monmouth Hawks from Damascus High School program. He's a very fast, physical player. He's also shown the ability to rush the passer off the edge, in addition to playing off the line of scrimmage. So he's very versatile in what he can do. Charles James is another offensive lineman from here locally at Union High School in New Jersey. And Charles is a very tall, long, athletic body that we project to play the tackle position. He's got very good bend. He moves his feet extremely well, and he has the potential to continue to grow. As you can see, he's not in that 300-pound category right now, but he's got a lot of room to fill out and continue to grow. Adam Kakar is a defensive tackle from Toms River North here in the Shore Conference, but he also spent a semester at Milford Academy in upstate New York. Adam joined Monmouth University, enrolled here in January, so he has the benefit of working with us throughout this winter and spring before we head into his freshman year. And he's a big, physical, strong interior defensive lineman. He's got excellent strength. He plays very stout against the run, but he's also shown the ability to push the pocket from the inside and collapse it on the quarterback. Lowell Kelly Gamble is the other defensive lineman in this class. He's a defensive end from Bloomfield High School in New Jersey, played for Coach Mike Carter there. He's an explosive physical player that we project to play on the edge. He's an edge rusher with the ability to turn the corner. He's shown the ability to chase down plays from behind. He's got good closing speed. He's got good acceleration. He's a very explosive player. Lonnie Moore is the 2nd receiver in this class, and Lonnie comes from Paul VI High School in the southern part of the state of New Jersey. And Lonnie is a very quick, explosive player. He's going to project to play in one of our inside receiver positions. He's also an excellent kick return specialist and can contribute on special teams there. He's got very good hands. He's got very good redirection and the ability to change directions at top speed. And he has also shown the ability to run after the catch. So we think he brings with us some explosive big play capability. Matt Mascara is coming to us from Middletown South, another high school here in the Shore Conference. Matt did a lot of things for Middletown South. He was their quarterback, he was their punter, and he was their place kicker. He's a very versatile athlete. He's coming to us as a place kicker, and he really impressed us at our summer camp here back in June. Spent about an hour and a half with us kicking, showed the ability to make all the kicks, extremely accurate, and converted 164 of 168 kicks during high school. That's place kicks and field goals combined. Evan Powell is the second linebacker in this class. And Evan comes from Cherokee High School down in Burlington County here in New Jersey. He's been called the best linebacker in the history of Cherokee High School football. And for those of you that know local New Jersey football, you know that that's perennially one of the top teams in the state. He's got very quick feet. He plays with power at the point of attack. He's a very athletic for the inside linebacker position. He's a firm tackler. And he joins his brother Jake, who's currently a tight end here in our Monmouth program. Mahmoud Shabana is another one of the offensive linemen in this class. Mahmoud played at Brooklyn Tech High School in New York City. Mahmoud is a very tall, long offensive lineman that we're projecting to play the tackle position. He moves very well. He plays physical. What impressed us most about him was he's a very good finisher. At 260 pounds, he still has some room to grow, and we're excited about his potential as we move forward. Shamar Shanks is the third linebacker in this class, and Shamar comes from the Gilman School down in Baltimore, Maryland. It's a very, very high-powered program that plays a national schedule. He's an excellent linebacker on a very good team. He's got very quick hands and feet. He's got great explosiveness, bends very well. He has the ability to play either the inside or the outside linebacker position. He's shown the ability to rush the passer in third down situations, and that's something that we may use him to do as well. Brian Syracuse is another one of the offensive linemen in this class. He comes from Nanuet High School in the state of New York. He's got very good size. He was an all New York State player that we're going to project to play one of the interior positions, either the guard or the center positions. He really impressed us at our camp this summer with his intensity, his ability to stay on his feet, and his competitiveness. He's the type of player we need in the interior offensive line position. Mike Welsh is the quarterback in this class, and Mike comes from Shawnee High School, also in Burlington County here in New Jersey. He's a very successful high school quarterback from, again, another one of the perennial New Jersey, Southern New Jersey power high schools. He impressed us with really his decision-making, his decision-making ability. He gets the ball out very quickly. He's got great intangibles. He's a tremendous leader on the field. He's got a very smooth release. He knows where he's going with the ball. He brings really all the things you want in the quarterback position. He also has the ability to extend plays and make plays with his feet. And the last member of this year's class is Keith Williams. Keith is a 6'7 offensive lineman from Overly High School down in Baltimore, Maryland. And obviously, he's a very tall, long, athletic body. We're projecting him to play a tackle position. We've seen him, we've watched him play basketball in high school. He's a very athletic player. But for as big as he is, he has a tremendous ability to bend. He moves his feet extremely well and has demonstrated a high level of athleticism when watching him play basketball. Those are the 17 members of the 2016 class here at Monmouth University. And I guess at this time, I'll open it up to any questions that you may have.
The right education can inspire you to do anything. Challenge yourself. Prepare for success. This is your moment to create, explore, discover, matter to each other and to the world. Be inspired to do anything at Monmouth University.
What do you do when you're already the number one Subaru dealer at the shore? You just keep getting bigger and better than ever. We're proud to announce that World Subaru is now number one in all of Central and South Jersey. How'd we do it? By giving our customers the most for their money with our exclusive VIP program, including oil changes, tire rotations, loaner cars, car washes, and much, much more. Start saving now. WorldSubaru.com.
Everyone wants to move forward. Where will you be tomorrow? Here or here? The right education can inspire you to do anything. So why not make a difference? Explore new worlds. Expand your options. Let tomorrow start today in a graduate program at Monmouth University.
An exciting day here in West Long Branch, New Jersey. You just heard from the head coach of the Hawks, Kevin Callahan, as he announces the 17-member class that will enter after this academic year and be part of the 2016 Hawks and moving forward. Monmouth last year going 5-6 overall, 3-3 within the Big South. We will throw things over right now to Eddie Acapinti, standing by with former Monmouth wide receiver Neil Sterling.
Now, Matt, thank you very much. And Neil, first of all, thank you so much for coming back to campus. How are you doing today?
I'm good, man. It's good to be here.
And it's great to have you back on campus. And before we talk about what today means, National Signing Day, obviously a great year for you with the Jacksonville Jaguars, seventh round pick. Take us through your first year in Jacksonville and getting used to NFL life.
It was an interesting year, you know, just being a rookie and just trying to learn the ropes and learn from the vets. It was a very interesting year. I think I did the most learning I've ever did in my life within, you know, 6 months of playing at this, you know, level at, that I'm playing at. And it was a great experience. You know, I got some playing time, learned a lot, and, you know, I'm just trying to, you know, look toward the future and become a better player.
You obviously spent so much time at the wide receiver position throughout your whole life up to this point. And then Jacksonville, getting some time on special teams and doing other things. And take us through that for what it was like you learning now that whole other side of the game. Obviously still getting time at wide receiver, but now adding that to your repertoire as well.
Yeah, it's a position that's not really talked about. You know, everyone always talks about offense and defense. But, you know, special teams is a part of the game that not a lot of people know about. And there's a lot of time and you know, film and effort put into it, and it was real fun playing. You know, it actually kind of took me back to my high school days when I played a little bit of defense. You know, I was out there making some key blocks out there, and you know, making a couple tackles here and there, and it was fun running around and, you know, getting to play. First off, just getting to play at that level, and you know, I'll take any type of, you know, playing on the field, whether it's special teams or offense or whatever it is. And it was a fun experience, and I really appreciated it.
You know, take us back to your time here at Monmouth. When the Monmouth program transitioned into the Big South, it was a step up in the level of competition. You kept your great momentum and great production going. And how much better was playing in the Big South against players that you'll probably see on Sundays in that upper level of competition?
Yeah, it was a different level of competition. You know, just moved from NEC to Big South. Like you said, the competition was that much better, and I think it made me better as a player as a whole, and it also made our team better. You know, we knew we couldn't get away with the same stuff that we were getting away with the past, you know, 3 years of playing in NEC when we're playing against, you know, a couple ranked teams that are in your conference every year, and it was a fun experience, and I think it helped me as a player and helped the program as a whole.
You know, Neil, now take us back, I'm curious, to this day for you, National Signing Day, a couple of years ago when you were coming out of Manasquan High School. What was the recruiting process like for you that ultimately led to your decision to come to Monmouth?
I actually wasn't getting too many looks coming out of high school. Monmouth was one of my favorite, you know, schools and programs. You know, I had a pretty good relationship with Coach Callahan before coming here. But, yeah, I wasn't really highly recruited, and I think I had made my decision to come to Monmouth. I think it was the December prior to, you know, signing date. And signing date came, and it was an exciting day. I woke up, went to my high school. That was, had, like, some big thing, you know, me and a couple of the guys at my high school were also signing that day. And it was a big day for, you know, me and my family, and I was, you know, happy with my decision.
How much of a relief was it when you made your decision, got to use the fax machine? It's the only day of the year it seems the fax machine is relevant, but was it a huge relief on your shoulders then to then go out as you were playing basketball at the time and then go out and have the rest of your high school career?
Yeah, of course. You know, just leading up to that point, it was just all about football, you know, just the decision, you know, what am I going to do? You know, just thinking that this decision could, you know, shape the rest of my life and the rest of my football career and everything. It was definitely a big burden off my shoulders, and it was definitely a relief. Yeah, like you said, I was playing basketball at the time, and you know, I basically got to just finish out my season, have a good time, and you know, next year I'll be at Monmouth.
You know, Neil, what would you say to the student athletes who committed to Monmouth today that have aspirations of playing in the NFL like you are doing now? What would you tell them from today through the process of when you got drafted? What would be your kind of most important things or themes for them to keep in mind as they go through this process?
I would probably tell them to, you know, follow the process. You know, sometimes things might not seem that, you know, they might be helping you, or, you know, sometimes you might think coaches don't have your best interest, but in reality they do. And, you know, whatever you put into this program and, you know, the team is what you're going to get out of it, no matter what. No matter what you do in life, you know. I would just tell the people coming in this year to, you know, just make sure you stay hard, keep working hard, and, you know, follow the process, and everything will, you know, hopefully come out the way expected.
That's great advice, and obviously it worked for you. Second year, going to enter your second year with the Jaguars. We appreciate you not only coming back but taking a few minutes. Thank you so much.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
It's former Monmouth Hawk Neil Sterling here on National Signing Day, and there he is, currently a member of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Matt, we send it back to you.
That was number 17 for Monmouth, one of the best to ever put on the blue and white uniforms here in Monmouth. We thank Neil for coming by and giving us some time talking about things here on signing day, which is such an exciting time for, obviously, high school athletes as they make that transition, decide on things, where they're going to go. And we're fortunate here to be part of a busy day of coverage on ESPN3. Started off this morning with Georgia Tech, Bowling Green. We saw Duke in Miami. Now into some of the FCS stuff here with Monmouth. And you think about where the Hawks are going right now. 5-6 a season ago overall. Let's start with some of the non-league games. Holy Cross, a tough loss to open up the season. But let's focus on that first away game at Central Michigan, a 31-10 loss. And Eddie, when you think about it, obviously that was a milestone game for the Hawks, even in a loss, playing their first ever FBS game.
It was also, Matt, a big measuring stick game for this Hawks football program. As you said, first matchup against an FBS opponent, against a Chippewa team that went to a bowl game again this season. Monmouth shut them out in the second half, didn't allow any points, and I think proved to themselves and other people around the country that, you know what, they can play at that level of competition in NCAA football, and I think that helped them the rest of the season with obviously how good the Big South is.
Wins over Wagner and Bryant, old schools from the Northeast Conference, sandwiching a loss around Fordham, and I think that was one of those games that was a bit of a measuring stick game for Monmouth. You know, Fordham, one of the top teams in all of FCS football. They've been a perennial playoff team over the course of the last couple of years. Chase Edmonds, one of the top players. They've got some outstanding talent up there in the Bronx. And, you know, you say, well, 54-31. But I think, obviously, Monmouth wants to win those games. But it certainly does give you an idea of what you need to do to close the gap between some of the better and higher-level FCS programs.
The biggest shock to us, you and I were there that day, was just how good and how fast Fordham was at the skill positions. You mentioned Chase Edmonds, just a tremendous quarterback in Anderson as well, and what they were able to do. But that's one of those games that Kevin Callahan and his staff looked at. They knew it was a play-up game against a team in Fordham that regularly visits the FCS playoffs. And I think the biggest eye-opener, Matt, was just the speed at how Fordham plays and, again, the depth. Fordham really can come at you in waves in that game. And I wouldn't be surprised if I just spoke to Neil Sterling. He's in the NFL. Chase Edmonds is going to find himself in the NFL one day as well. And obviously, Monmouth was able to put points on the board that day, but Fordham was obviously good. Again, we were there, but it was a big eye-opener for where they need to be.
2-3 in the non-league portion of the schedule a season ago, but 3-3 in the Big South, and that was a big move up for this Monmouth football program, a team that went 1-4 the prior year in terms of where they were in their first ever year in the Big South. 3-3, finished up with wins over Presbyterian and Gardner-Webb, and had the school's first ever win over a ranked opponent against Liberty.
We had that call here on ESPN3. That was a tremendous game for the Hawks, late win, and I think we really learned a lot about this team in that game. It was all on the shoulders of the young redshirt freshman quarterback, Cody Williams. A great defensive performance in that game as well, but Monmouth started to see playmakers really start to, Matt, come to the forefront. Not only LaVon Chaney in the backfield, but great wideouts like Reggie White Jr. and Darren Ambush. That was game number one that really made the national scene took notice. And then to go out and almost upset the top team in the country in Coastal Carolina was another big eye-opener.
And the Big South, yet again, one of the traditional powers in all of FCS football, put Coastal back into the playoff. Charleston Southern got the automatic bid in the league. And again, those games are the ones that you want to think about when you are trying to close that gap. Monmouth, I think, made big steps in the 2015 season, looking ahead and looking forward to what will hopefully be, obviously, a very successful 2016 year.
And part of today goes into that, obviously, and the new players that are coming into the program. But a lot of talent comes back from this team a season ago, Matt, in 2016, to go from one win in the league to three, trending upward, like we said in our open. And it's just more to improve on and continue to try to reach forward as with the ultimate goal of making the FCS playoffs.
And that 2015 year for Monmouth started off with a little bit of a bad note, especially on the defensive side of the ball. When you think about it, obviously, things didn't really get off the way that Monmouth would have wanted on that defensive side. Darnell Leslie out for the entire year. The defensive line, all in all, was decimated all year long. And so much is expected of that unit. In a year last year for Monmouth, making a transition with the back seven, so many young players, they just didn't have it up front all during the course of the year.
And when you're trying to break in new players in the secondary, and it sounds like coach speak, but it's true, you have to generate a pass rush and try and do so with your four down linemen. If you have to commit linebackers up, then you really leave yourself exposed on the back end. Monmouth has a lot of talent coming back in that secondary position, but the problem was when it's game two, three, four for them and they're still learning things, to learn on the fly, not very easy. Obviously, word out is that Darnell is progressing along. Hopefully, we'll be ready for the upcoming season. But there were other guys along that defensive line, Matt, that were injured throughout the year. Some guys had to be transitioned in, step into maybe positions they weren't used to playing in. And you learned a lot about some of the younger guys, some of the really good young players, the Trey Nelsons of the world, the Diego Zubietas of the world, who had to put time, maybe get their hand on the ground, get to the quarterback. But obviously, that's something when Monmouth has these signing day things. You break all these new players in earlier, they're going to get on the field earlier. Last season, it was due to injury.
And a note offensively for Monmouth, Hawks last year breaking in a brand new quarterback, and not just a new quarterback like they had in the past. Let's point to Brandon Hill, who a couple years was new into the system, but an older player. He had transferred. He had played at a different level. For Cody Williams, he got his first game action at the collegiate level ever, certainly progressed during the course of the year, but as you would expect, he really had some struggles as a young redshirt freshman quarterback.
What was the ups and downs that I think you'll see with a rookie quarterback? And again, second year in college, but first year on the field. For Cody to have his second game be it, Monmouth's first ever FBS opponent in Central Michigan, that was a big learning experience. The schedule that Monmouth put in front of him was a very challenging one. But as you said, he was younger, but he also brought a different element to what Monmouth quarterbacks have done in the past. More of a dual threat guy, can make plays with his legs. And I think as the year went on, Cody Williams learned exactly how to do that. Not that he's going to do it right away, but when a play breaks down, eyes downfield, but you could still pick up 5-6 yards with your legs, still has some learning to do. Threw a tough interception in that game against Coastal Carolina when Monmouth was driving at home, but he really got better as the year went on, including a couple of wins to end the season.
We've got a ton of more stuff coming up. We'll come back. Eddie and I will talk about the 2016 class, which will be on campus in September. ESPN's coverage of National Signing Day continues here in West Long Branch.
Your health is a precious resource, the foundation for everything you do. So at Barnabas Health, we do all we can to restore, protect, and improve it. Should you need care, we offer world-renowned specialists and amazing technology. Yet we also have hundreds of programs to help you avoid the need for that care in the first place. We're here for your health, so you can live, love, work, play, and dream. Barnabas Health. Life is better, healthy.
I first started working with ESPN probably in the fall of this past year.
The production side here has really helped me because I'm able to put on a resume now that I've tech directed or directed ESPN games.
I want the school to be the best. I want the athletic department to be the best. And we're lucky enough to be blessed with upper administration that believe in that same philosophy.
A busy day of coverage here on all of the ESPN family of networks. ESPNU has been going since the early stages of the morning. We'll continue it all the way through the late stages of tonight. Who still uses a fax machine, by the way? I mean, in this age of technology, we still got people faxing letters in? I've never heard of such a thing anymore.
You have NFL players signing contracts on tablets, on airplanes, but yet it still comes down to fax machines to determine where you're going to go to college. When I asked Neil that question, he lit up because even he realizes it. He probably hasn't seen a fax machine since then. It's unbelievable that that's still the way that college decisions get made.
I'm pretty sure nobody sees the fax machine other than maybe one day, and this is it. That first Wednesday in February is the day that, hey, let's get the dust off and make sure this thing works, because imagine that thing doesn't get used all year and then all of a sudden, hey, we're not getting any letters. What's going on? Oh, someone disconnected it. We don't use that except for one day in February.
Can you imagine the chaos that would ensue if the fax machine at a college football program didn't work? The compliance staff alone would lose their minds that day. That's unbelievable.
We've got some good stuff coming up for you in the second half of the program. We'll talk with recruiting coordinator and assistant coach Brian Gabriel. We'll break things down in terms of this class and give a state of the union, so to speak, of Monmouth football when the head coach Kevin Callahan swings by. But Eddie and I have some time now to talk about this class specifically. And I'm sure you were doing the same thing last night, partner. I was spending time looking up video of these guys, trying to get a real sense of them. We'll have highlight video, obviously, as we talk about some of these guys. But this seems like a pretty good group for Monmouth. And of course, everybody's going to say that. Everybody's excited about what they have going on. A couple of things obviously jump out at me as we talk about the 17 guys, 10 from New Jersey. You and I were sitting here a year ago talking about Monmouth making inroads into the state of Florida. I'm actually among those who say I'm pretty thrilled to know that they're back at home and recruiting some of the top players here from the Garden State.
And you and I have spoken to Kevin Callahan a bunch on days like this, and he always talks about his recruiting philosophy being, and I'm sure he'll say it later and kind of build on it, but he always talks about it being inside out. Talks about first the area around Monmouth University and Monmouth and Ocean County, but then New Jersey as a whole. You played in this program. There's a lot of Jersey pride in the Monmouth football program, and it's a return to that, as you said, with the 10 student athletes that come from the Garden State. That also leads to all the other things. Family and friends coming to games. Leads to a great atmosphere at football games. But that's a great sign that the talent, and New Jersey has a ton of high school football talent. They're starting to make, again, those decisions to come to Monmouth University because, again, the increased level of play, the scholarships, obviously. And as maybe you saw in the background when I interviewed Neil, new facilities on the way, which we'll also talk to Coach about.
I was a part of the program, by the way, all the way back in 1993. I love that you throw that in every once in a while, but I'll tell you one thing. I certainly couldn't play with these guys anymore. Not a question about it. A 17-player class. We talk about some of the 10 players from New Jersey. That overlooks right now what is Kessler Field and Monmouth Stadium. That will obviously change over the course of the next couple of years. A groundbreaking hopefully will commence after the start, after the end, I should say, of the 2016 season. The target date for that new stadium is 2017 and the beginning of that year. So let's talk about some of these guys a little bit more specifically. Let's think position-wise. There is obviously a need at one group specifically, and when we talk with Brian Gabriel, I think he's going to be the happiest guy in the coach's room because he's also the offensive line coach. Six guys up front, some of the big guys.
You really can't have enough offensive linemen, especially with the way Monmouth wants to play football, control the line of scrimmage. It's still very much a 50-50 run-pass team. And if you get young linemen in the program, Matt, and the better they are, the maybe sooner they'll play. But again, and he'll say, you can't have enough really good offensive linemen. Monmouth was dinged up a couple of seasons ago on the O-line. That's where things can either flourish or break down offensively. You can have all the skill guys you want, but if the big guys up front don't protect, then your offensive system breaks down.
So six offensive linemen, three linebackers, two defensive linemen, two defensive backs, two wide receivers, one quarterback, and one kicker. The kicker, by the way, was one of the top quarterbacks in the state of New Jersey in a local product, Matt Mascara, from Middletown South High School. Won a state championship during the course of this past year and generally regarded as the top team in the state of New Jersey. I like the balance that you see in this class. And obviously, as you said, you can never have enough offensive linemen. Every year, you always have to cycle through a couple defensive linemen. So the balance is there. Obviously, the one thing that's missing there is a running back. It's a position that Monmouth feels like is one of strength. You could probably skip a year in it, be able to go out and get an extra offensive lineman or two and begin to replenish there.
Again, LaVon Chaney looks to lead the backfield for Monmouth moving forward, but a lot of guys that saw time a season ago, Matt, still kind of factor in to what they'll want to do. And again, you don't recruit every single position every year. You also sometimes hear coaches, you know, you got to leave room. Things may happen. Today's just the beginning of this. Obviously, it's the end with guys signing, but still the beginning of this process. There's still a lot of people still making decisions. Not with this Monmouth class. They're pretty much solidified. But you take a look at the breakdown of the class, and what have we seen in the Big South? Opposing teams' defensive lines are incredibly talented and incredibly big and fast. So you need more offensive linemen. Also, the linebackers, because it's more of a ground-based league. There's very few teams in this conference that really air it out. really spread you out. You're going to get a lot of quarterbacks running the football, and you're going to get a lot of teams that still run power. You've got to solidify up front and at that linebacker position where Monmouth last year was in flux, working new guys in. Peyton Minnick moving into the middle, had a really nice season, and these young guys look to filter in right behind him.
Let's look specifically at some of the all the key members of this class, all 17 certainly key members. We've got some really good video, however, to show you about some of the guys that we were able to dig some of the better video up, and it's certainly not done in any order other than just those that we could get the better video of to be able to show you, our viewing audience. Let's start with Wendell Allen, local guy, one of those New Jersey products. He's a guy that, if you look size-wise, 6 foot, 175 pounds, plays in the defensive backfield, the guy that I think might be able to come in and recognize that he could play right away.
Well, he's got one thing that it's hard to teach defensive backs, and that's size. A lot of the receivers in the Big South matter bigger bodies, 6'4", 6'5". Wendell Allen at 6 foot and 175 pounds right now, you know that number will go up when he gets on campus. From South Brunswick, a New Jersey powerhouse in the center part of the state. Also saw time on the offensive end, but on defense is where he'll make his name here in West Long Branch. Again, a bigger defensive back, not afraid to hit you. You can also leave him, as you can see, out on an island, and he can cover the opposing team's outside speed threat.
You know, one of the interesting things about some of these guys, and Allen, one of them, he had offers from Maine. He had some interest from UMass. He had offers from Towson on the table, from Stony Brook. I saw a video of him, very well-spoken young man. I saw him in a post-game interview after one of the South Brunswick wins, and he was talking about, yeah, I've been to camps at Syracuse, and I've had some interest at Rutgers and Pitt. And now all of a sudden you're seeing Monmouth be able to go toe-to-toe and head-to-head with some of the bigger and better FCS programs and also some of the FBS schools. That's what you're really looking for to make that next step, I feel like. And Wendell Allen might be one of those guys who was a fringe FBS guy who, if you get him in the FCS level, he could turn out to be a pretty good one.
And he joins a position of strength, I think, for this team moving forward. They lose Joe Johnson, who was just a veteran, a stalwart guy, played so well in his time at cornerback for Monmouth. But Wendell Allen joins a group of young corners that are very good. Marcus Leslie, Tymir Berry, Lakeith Celestine, and just more guys even behind there. So he'll fit right into a group that likes to be aggressive, likes to single guys up on the outside, and he, I think, is comfortable in that scheme after, again, watching, like you said, and knowing some of the level he was involved with before ultimately deciding to come to Monmouth.
Let's change gears and flip to the other side of the football. Let's talk about one of the offensive guys. Wide receiver was a position that had a lot of youth last year, and as that unit started to continue to come together a little bit, they're adding a couple of more pieces this season. Two wide receivers, one of those being Bryce Barney's from Colonia High School, 6 foot, 160 pounds. Watched him a little bit last night on the film. He's a guy that can play in the slot. He's a guy that can play outside, very dynamic. And you can see 6 foot, 160 pounds. One thing, Eddie, that I mentioned, see right there, you could put 15 pounds on him, and I don't think you're going to lose anything speed-wise.
Yeah, I agree, Matt, and he's comfortable playing a variety of wide receiver positions. Again, receiver ended up being a position of strength for Monmouth with Reggie White Jr., Darren Ambush and company leading the way, but there's a good young group behind that. But if you've got top-end speed like Bryce Barney's does, and you see it there, it really makes the offense go, and it opens up the playbook for what Kevin Morris and company want to do offensively. The team he was a member of at Colonia, he led those Patriots to back-to-back conference championships. So a guy that comes in with a winning pedigree, and it's great when you recruit winners because they bring that element in, even though it was high school, into their preparation at the college level.
Barney's had offers from Albany and Maine. So again, Monmouth, you know, as the lone school up here in the Big South, that's a northern type school, they're not necessarily always going against those teams that they will play in league. They're going against the CAA teams, the Patriot League schools, and Barney's a guy that obviously Monmouth feels pretty good about. Another guy they feel pretty good about, let's stay on the offensive side of the ball, talk about the other wide receiver that's part of the group, and that is Lonnie Moore. 5'10", 160 pounds, went to Paul VI High School from Sickerville, New Jersey. Another talented guy, a guy that can play all spots, probably more of an inside guy, good return guy that could help Monmouth in that department as well.
He's a versatile offensive guy, and that's what you like. You want weapons on the offensive side of the ball, and Lonnie Moore from South Jersey is that. Three times first team all-league honoree. Matt, not just over 2,000 yards receiving in his career, but he also ran for over 1,000 yards, scored 32 touchdowns. So what he can do is, again, he's a weapon. Get him the football in space, let him do work. You can see he's comfortable, obviously, turning up field, catching a screen and going. And a again, it's top-end speed that we see in the Big South that sometimes can be the difference on Saturdays. Lonnie Moore, a guy that comes in, he really is a good route runner as well, and he's a guy that will factor into this position, again, a little on the smaller side, under 6 foot, but if you're a great route runner with great hands, that can separate you at the wide receiver position.
I think one of the things you talked about before, Eddie, is key to this class. So six offensive linemen, right after that, three linebackers. You talk about the way that schools like to run the football. Not only do you need guys in that linebacker spot that can come up and make hit, but you also need guys that can probably be versatile, drop into coverage if you need to. You talked about some of the young guys from a season ago, a Trey Nelson, a Diego Zubieta, guys that were probably more outside linebackers that had to play defensive end. Those guys got experience, but this three-man group as part of the linebackers, I love what I saw out of these guys. Daquan Grimes, 5'11", 205 pounds, went to Damascus High School, where Monmouth has had so much success. It's been kind of an inroad down there. Evan Powell, who has a brother on the program, and Jake Powell from Cherokee High School, and Shamar Shanks, the 6'2", 210-pound player from the Gilman School, one of the top programs down in the Baltimore area. All of these guys, I think, again, you're looking at guys because we saw it last year. We saw young linebackers that could step up to the challenge and play. I don't see a reason why some of these guys couldn't be part of that mix as well.
And we saw it in the Big South. You can't just play downhill. You've got to be able to play side to side and deliver the big hit like you see Grimes able to do there. He's a guy, again, he's comfortable playing sideline to sideline, and when he had to face, and the level of competition he did at Damascus was fantastic. You know he's going to see similar to that on Saturdays here in the Big South. And Evan Powell from Marlton, New Jersey, the South Jersey product from Cherokee. You talk to some of the coaches with that program, see the comments they're making. He's one of the best players they think to come out of that program, which has put guys all up and down FBS football programs. You mentioned his brother Jake is a tight end on the Monmouth roster. His 297 career tackles is the most in school history. This is a guy with the size, again, will probably factor in the middle and could play early on for this Monmouth program. Again, he is a guy, Matt, physically more ready, I think, than other high school linebackers just by pure size.
And I think what you're talking about is you see some of these guys, you've got good, solid programs that these players are coming from. You've got Damascus. You've got the Gilman School from the Maryland area, as we look at Shamar Shanks coming up, 6'2", 210-pound freshman from down in Baltimore, and obviously Powell at Cherokee. These aren't just good players. These are good players who come from good programs, who are used to winning, who have that tradition and almost the background that you want to bring in to the Monmouth program.
You want winners. You want guys that have won at every level, and they would continue, theoretically, to win in college. Shamar Shanks has that pedigree. Number 2 ranked team in Maryland was the Gilman School. How about a number 19 national ranking, 88 tackles his senior season. Monmouth has always done well in that Baltimore, Virginia area, that Maryland area, and Shamar Shanks, along with Daquan Grimes, another guy that factors into that group, and another linebacker that can really run. And again, that's the key with him especially, and with Grimes, you can add weight. They're going to get into the weight room, and they're going to get bigger before they play. But what you want is guys, again, that can run. You want athletes that can come up and run support, and as like you said, Matt, they can fall back into coverage.
Let's finish our video profiles of some of the 17 players and the 10 from New Jersey. We'll wrap things up with another Maryland guy, offensive lineman, 6'7", 270 pounds, Keith Williams from down in Baltimore. Talk about a prototypical guy. Big size, 6'7", 270. Again, add 20, 30 pounds. This guy's going to be a beast once he just grows into that body a little bit.
When we throw the circle on Keith Williams, I want you to notice something. He's bigger than the circle. He's 6'7", right now 270, as you said, has the frame to support more weight. And you know Brian Gabriel absolutely loves that kind of body on a tackle where he'll project here in college. He played offensive tackle, obviously, 3 times, an all-division guy. And Matt, a player that I think the coaches are really excited about. Again, he's got great footwork. He's got long arms. He's able to get that punch out there. And really, in the Big South, that's huge. Again, how many really good defensive linemen did we see all season? You can't have enough depth up front.
No, no doubt about that. And Monmouth hopes that they were able to get that done with 6 players in this class of 17. We'll take a quick timeout when we come back. Our continuing coverage of signing day will roll along with recruiting coordinator Brian Gabriel. We're live from Monmouth University in New Jersey.
Hi. Hi, I'm Dr. Daniel Rises, owner of Advanced PMR, and I'm here to tell you what sets us apart from the rest. We first evaluate and identify your functional limitations and goals to create an individualized treatment plan. No two are alike. We've combined cutting-edge treatments to help speed your recovery and keep you off the sidelines. We are proud to be an official provider of Monmouth University students, staff, faculty, and alumni.
Go Hawks!
Everyone wants to move forward. Where will you be tomorrow? Here or here? The right education can inspire you to do anything. So why not make a difference? Explore new worlds. Expand your options. Let tomorrow start today in a graduate program at Monmouth University.
The right education can inspire you to do anything. Challenge yourself. Prepare for success. This is your moment to create, explore, discover, matter to each other and to the world. Be inspired to do anything at Monmouth University.
Stay connected with the Monmouth Hawks on a variety of digital platforms. Make sure to use hashtag FlyHawks to maximize your unique interactive fan experience. You'll find all official Monmouth Athletics social media accounts at monmouthhawks.com/connect. Keep up with the Hawks wherever you are and join the online conversation today.
One of the funnest days of college football alongside recruiting coordinator and assistant coach, offensive line coach Brian Gabriel. I'm Matt Harmon. We're back here from Monmouth University after the 17-player class was introduced. That's how we started. And now we get a little bit more in depth from a man who, well, you have to wake up in the morning and either you're just a big ball of nerves or probably at this point you get to take a little bit of a just deep breath and relax just a bit, right?
Certainly at this point we get a chance to relax. The last 48 hours and, you know, the last few weeks have just been crazy, as all our wives will attest to, being on the road. And this morning I woke up honestly excited about this class. I felt comfortable with the guys we had committed to sign. I felt comfortable that they were going to sign. It was an all their houses or schools in the last week, and felt good about it, and there really no surprises. So that's always a good thing. Surprises aren't a good thing today. So that was a very good thing for us.
When you think about it, you know, the one thing that I was told walking in this morning, getting ready for the broadcast, was that by 10 o'clock this morning, you guys had everybody off the fax machine. Everyone had signed their letter in. So there were really no second thoughts or last minute kind of players deciding, well, maybe I'm going to want to go somewhere else. That's got to make you feel real good, just that the commitment that all these guys was so strong.
Yeah, certainly. And one of the things, I really try to instill in our coaches, and our coaches do a great job, is we want guys who want to be at Monmouth University as well and see what Monmouth University can do for them in our football program. Coming in this morning, a lot of guys got it between 7:30. You know, for them, this is the culmination of their high school careers and their opportunity to start the next part. And they're as excited as we are about receiving them as they are about signing them. Certainly their families are as well. So I know it's a huge day for our commits and our now signees and our now football players that they can sign, and they do it in front of their families, and just what that means to their families as well and how excited. And that's what I always tell guys when they commit to me. I said, you know, this is great for me, but, you know, how excited are you? This is such a big thing. And now, as I told them all last week, once you sign, it starts all over again. Now you got to go back to work, because that's just the beginning.
So I got to ask you this, because I think this is a fun little fact when you look at this particular class. I know that you're the recruiting coordinator, and of the hundreds and thousands of videos that you watch of all of this particular class and all of the staff meetings, how does the offensive line coach be the one guy who comes away with six players from his position? I mean, yeah. Did you change a couple of things somewhere along the way that nobody knew about?
Well, certainly I flex a little muscle at times, but what I would say to you is this. We could have had the same conversation last year and only taken one. So the opportunity just with the needs we have. We had a bunch of seniors last year, and as Coach talked about before, it wasn't a position of need as much last year because we had a lot of guys coming back who had played for us. This year's class, you know, we do have some good young players in our program, but this is certainly the foundation, this offensive line for the offensive lines for years to come, and it was just a huge need for us in this class, the thing we've most identified, and the thing every meeting I would say, bring me back, show me tape. Any old lineman who can play, show me the tape so we can evaluate them and take that next step.
You know, one of the things that I've found so interesting is Monmouth has made those trips down to the Big South and playing everybody in the league, is everybody in the league always says the same thing whenever I talk to opposing coaches or media people. Boy, Monmouth is big, big and physical. They have all those New Jersey guys and Northeast guys that play on the offensive line. But yet, you know, I don't know that that always defines who Monmouth is offensively, but it's the perception of the program that just because you're in the Northeast or the Mid-Atlantic, you always get those big, bruising offensive line type players.
That's for sure. And there's no doubt a lot of the Southern schools come up this area to recruit linemen. For whatever reason, you go down south to recruit skill, and you come up here to recruit bigger guys, just tough guys, guys who you don't know wear sleeves and all those things that we love about these guys in this class is no exception, which is how tough and physical they are.
You know, one of the things that I always find interesting, too, about the offensive linemen is that it might be a year before we see any of these guys. We could be talking and doing our 2016 recap next year in 2017 on signing day and saying, boy, can't wait to see what some of the offensive linemen that Mama signed, because as is a custom and normally the case, you don't necessarily want to throw those guys onto the field right away. You want to give them a year, put some weight on, get in the weight room. I'll say, with no disrespect, get some of the baby fat off and really transform their bodies a little bit. This might not be a group that we won't see really impact over the course of not next season, but we might need to wait 2 or 3 years to really see them.
I agree with you 100%. It seems like, in my experience, I've been here now for 12 years now, and it seems like to me the offensive line is the hardest position to come right away into college and compete. Certainly physically, the maturation of a 17-year-old kid to, you know, a 22, 23-year-old man that they're playing against is a huge difference. And the language and all the calls that have to be made, clearly it's not something you pick up very shortly. That being said, this class is, we're going to push them right away to compete, whether or not they're a backup this year or whether one of these guys can show that he has the ability to play for us and be one of our best five is yet to be seen. But this group certainly is going to play earlier than later. As you know, like 2 years ago when you bring guys in, you have a lot of juniors, seniors, you know, you have a little more luxury. This class we're going to push. We're going to push to play, and they're going to have to be ready to go. One of the nice things, bring them in a little early in the summer, have a chance to really spend that time with them to get them ready so that when camp comes, they're more ready than a traditional freshman would be.
Brian Gabriel, recruiting coordinator and offensive line coach, one of the associate head coaches here for the Monmouth program, been with the Hawks for a long time, talking about this class, 17 players, 10 of those from New Jersey, and let's take you to that one. You know, last year, so much of the, I'll say, excitement was, wow, Monmouth's getting guys from Florida. This year, it almost seems like Monmouth's gone back to its roots a little bit, get back into New Jersey, and not just into New Jersey, but some of the perennial powerhouse high school programs here in the Garden State.
Well, I certainly think that's the case. I would say a couple things about that. Like as Coach addressed before, there's no doubt we always want to work inside out. So we start looking at juniors right now. We're looking at class of 17 guys. And, you know, we're starting in the shore, starting in New Jersey. And we really, then we go to our secondary areas. And clearly Maryland is almost like the Jersey for us in the way we recruit it. But what we've also found is that coaches now know our third year in the league, the caliber of athlete we were getting. And I think our first year, you know, we were recruiting a higher athlete, and coaches in New Jersey didn't necessarily understand that. I think now as they see our class and the kids we're recruiting now, that it's clear to me that they're giving us a better level player. They're not shutting the door to us because they think the kid's a higher level than Monmouth. People in New Jersey are showing us the same kid, the kid we need to win the Big South, and luckily we've been able to identify that kid in New Jersey and keep him home.
Coach, last quick question for you. I know as players signed their NLIs today for the 2016 class, you got to get right back to work because it's a 24/7, 365-day-a-year business.
Sure. We started Monday. We already started evaluating juniors, and we're starting, like I said, in the shore, starting to look at all the best players in the shore, starting to look at all the best players in New Jersey, and kind of getting our board ready so that we can have these guys on campus for junior days, have them at camp in the summer, have them unofficially. You know, we're not quite to the level of the Big Ten and those things where they're starting with sophomores, but there's no doubt, you know, maybe enjoy tonight, and then tomorrow we're back at it and looking at 17 guys and trying to bring that next class in and get even a better class than we had this year, and that's always the goal.
Coach, well done. Thanks for giving us a little bit of time.
As always, Matt, thank you.
Brian Gabriel, the recruiting coordinator, offensive line coach here in Monmouth, will step away for just a brief moment. When we come back, we'll be joined at the table by the head coach of the Hawks, Kevin Callahan.
Monmouth men's lacrosse is back. One of the most improved teams in the nation one season ago, Coach Fisher and the Hawks are primed for a run at a conference title. Season tickets are on sale now. To guarantee your seat today, call 732-263-5735 or visit monmouthhawks.com.
Coverage that began at 8:30 this morning on ESPN3 and will run all the way through tonight. We've got covered everything on the ESPN family and networks. We're here from Monmouth University talking about the newest class of Hawks. We've got Kevin Callahan on tap, but before we do that, let's kick things over to Eddie Iacopinti.
Now, Matt, thank you very much. I'm here with the Vice President and Director of Athletics here at Monmouth University, Dr. Marilyn McNeil. And Marilyn, you've seen your fair share of these signing days, and how has the day grown in your time associated with the Monmouth football program? And as a collegiate administrator, it's just gotten to be so big, a day full of coverage on ESPN.
Well, that's an understatement about the change. It's been a sea change in terms of, I remember just standing at the fax machine 20 years ago. Today, and having this kind of formality and all the friends and family and the interest around it, having ESPN3 involved, people just asking really good questions, really mature questions about the program. So it's really exciting. It really, I think football has definitely arrived, and we're looking forward to just some wonderful years ahead.
You know, it's amazing, as great all the technological advances are, still a fax machine determines where you go to college. And you've said it. You've been associated with this program since it began way back when, in 1993. And you've seen the evolution of it moving into the Big South Conference. How have you seen it trend upward as far as going from one win to three wins and now full scholarship FCS football?
We knew this was going to be a challenge. We knew that the Big South was a conference that demanded more of its members. The program, the coaches, the players were excited to have that opportunity, and I think have really stepped up. The coaches have done a great job of improving our recruitment every year and of working with our athletes to make them Big South ready. And the next step is to get a bid and to get into the FCS championships. And that will be a really wonderful time for Monmouth football and will give us an opportunity to really showcase what we're all about, which I think is all good stuff.
And then if people can see behind us, obviously the future of the Monmouth football program looks bright as well, not only, as you mentioned, with this class of student athletes, but speak to them, their families right now, about where this program is headed, namely facility upgrades.
Well, this facility will get built. We have cleared the schedule in November to give the university a couple of extra months to build. I'm extremely optimistic that we will be in this gorgeous facility, and it's a facility that is deserved by 300 of our athletes, not only the football program, but the lacrosse and track and field programs. But it is a facility that is absolutely right for Monmouth and for this time and for our students and our student athletes. I think everybody will be so proud of it. It's a beautiful facility, and we're gonna see great things happen, and I can't wait to get that first AQ in FCS football.
We really appreciate a few minutes, and obviously the families of the 17 student-athletes, the nation watching. And Dr. McNeil, we really appreciate it.
Well, thanks, Eddie, and welcome to all the new Hawks. Can't wait to meet you and watch you compete. Thanks.
Matt, I share Marilyn's sentiments as we send it back over to you at the desk.
All right, Eddie, good stuff. I appreciate Dr. McNeil coming by and giving us a couple of minutes. The man off to my right, the head coach of the Monmouth football program, Kevin Callahan, the only coach that the program has ever known. And, Coach, let's start with the journey that these part of the class, the 2016 class. I mean, you start looking at these guys as early as sophomore, junior year, and somehow you're able to narrow it down to 17 players.
Well, it is a very comprehensive process, Matt, as you know. I mean, we're already recruiting 2017s and 2018s at this point, and it seems like you no sooner get one class signed and you're already well on to the next class. And I think it's a very long process, and you need to find out so much about these young men and have them find out a lot about you as well. You want to make sure that you're doing your diligence and that you're really taking care of every detail, and that process takes a long time. I can say that by the time a young man signs with us, he's probably been on our campus at least four times, if you count junior days and camps and game day visits and official visits. And I think it's important to get them here that many times with their parents so that they have a very good understanding of what we're all about as a university, what we're all about as a football program, and the people that they're going to be associated with.
When you think about the Monmouth program, there's been so many changes, not just in the now 24 years of the program, but I mean more specifically over the course of the last three. The year as the independent, the addition of scholarships. Now in the Big South, you'll go into year three as a full league member in football. And the one thing that I found so interesting in looking at the list that some of the offers that the players of this class had gotten from other schools is you are going head-to-head not really with the Big South schools. You have to compete with all the Northeast schools in the Patriot League and the CAA and some of the real top-level FCS schools.
Well, I think that, you know, geography obviously plays a part in that. And, you know, it's not that we are adverse to recruiting in North and South Carolina or the state of Florida, where a number of the Big South schools are. But we have such a rich talent base here in the state of New Jersey. And it's our philosophy to work from the inside out, to recruit the local player first, starting here in the Jersey Shore at the Shore Conference, which plays a tremendously high level of football, expanding out throughout the state of New Jersey, and then to the surrounding states, started going from Maryland through this eastern Pennsylvania up into New York State, and it's a very fertile ground for outstanding high school football. And I think that we can successfully recruit the young men that we need to take us to the Big South Championship, all within a three-hour radius of our campus.
So let's talk a little bit more about the Big South, Coach. Year one, one victory. Last year, three wins. That would seem to indicate a steady climb upward. What does Monmouth have to do to make that next step now? Because there's no more, probably, I would say, growing pains anymore. You know what the other schools have to offer. The other schools know what Monmouth has to offer. What's the next ability for Monmouth to make that jump to be a team that gets the automatic bid?
Well, I think what we have to do is continue building depth and continue increasing athletic talent. And I think in each of the last 2 years, we have done that. As you mentioned, in year one in the Big South, we found out that we could compete on the Big South level. We didn't win as many games as we had hoped, but we found out we could compete and play with every team in the league. Last season, our second in the conference, after building more depth and increasing the number of talented players that we have, we found that we could win in that conference. And we finished third place overall, and that represented a significant step from where we were in year number one. And I think the next logical step is to compete for the Big South Championship, to compete for the automatic qualifier that goes with the championship into the FCS playoffs. And that's what everybody associated with our program, from Dr. McNeil through our coaching staff and down to every player on our team, that's what we have on our minds first and foremost.
And one of the things that might make recruiting even a little bit easier, as Dr. McNeil and Eddie referenced in their interview, the addition of a brand new stadium. She mentioned basically Monmouth will be on the road all of November, so that hopefully the construction of the brand new project will be able to start and be ready for the 2017 year. It's something that I know your feelings on it. It is well deserved and certainly overdue, but it will be a really important piece of the Monmouth football puzzle.
It's going to be a tremendously important piece, and it's really a significant part of the plan that we put in place when we join the Big South. You know, first was obviously to increase and accelerate the number of scholarships players that we had in our program, and we're on track in doing what we need to do there. The second was to begin experiencing some success in terms of our on-the-field play in the Big South, and I think in 2015 we saw us begin to do that, although we're not completely happy where we are, but we were at the beginning stages of that. The other important piece, as you referenced, is the addition of a stadium, and it's something that's been in the works now for a couple of years. It's something that's critically important to our success moving forward and critically important to our ability to continue to recruit top-notch championship-caliber players.
Year one last year in terms of playing an FBS school in Central Michigan. Year two will be a game at Kent State. What does the Monmouth future schedule look like, just necessarily in terms of getting that one FBS game, which I know, again, recruiting-wise, it does help players say, hey, they're not just playing so-and-so, but they're playing some of the better schools around.
Philosophically, we have always, our program has always been based on playing the best competition that we could find and putting the best competition in front of our players each and every year and putting together a quality schedule. And the addition of an FBS team on the schedule, which is made possible by our moving out of our old conference, the NEC, and into a more high-powered conference in the Big South and adding additional scholarships is very important to continue to get that quality player. As you mentioned, we went out to Central Michigan this past year. In 2016, we will play Kent State. We're working on a couple of teams to solidify a 2017-2018 dates right now, but I think it's very safe to say and very feasible that we'll be playing members from the ACC or the American Conference as we move forward.
Let's talk about why we're here, obviously, the signing day. Tell me just how excited you are. You know, 24 years now in, does this day still, do you still have some nerves when you wake up in the morning hoping that the fax machine's going to be working?
Well, you're nervous until the time that you get those, that letter of intent signed and that grant and aid agreement signed. And, you know, whether it's fax or electronic transmission or however we get it nowadays, I mean.
Carrier pigeon?
Well, I'll tell you what, the athletes are a lot more savvy than that these days. They can get it to you very quickly. And, you know, it's always, I guess I could say, a relief or a reward to get that signed letter of intent. You know, our coaches put in so much time, as you mentioned, starting last spring, throughout the summer, throughout the fall, and really in the months of December and January, they are on the road 24/7, and they're for long hours at a time. And to get the reward of bringing this class to Monmouth University successfully, I think is a moment to celebrate for each and every one of the guys on the staff. Obviously, it's critically important to the future of the program to have quality recruiting classes. And when you're successful in doing that, it's similar to winning a big game. You know, you're excited about that. You're excited to have these young men join our family. You're excited to bring in this additional talent that's going to help us on the field and help us continue to build and become a better program.
And you've got 17 that signed their letter today, but that doesn't necessarily mean that will be all to come. There are always players that you can add from here until the time the training camp starts.
That's absolutely right. Today is simply the first day in which a player can sign a national letter of intent or a grant and aid agreement. It's certainly not the last day. There are a number of guys who we are still talking to and have the possibility of still signing. The 17 that we announced today were those that were ready and the process had come to a conclusion and they were ready to make their decision. We're happy to have them, but there are more out there as well.
I saved a specific question for you. I want to talk about Adam Kakar. He's the one mid-year guy who is on this list, already enrolled here at school, mid-year transfer, a guy that played at Toms River North High School, so a local guy, someone obviously you're very familiar with. That transition for a mid-year guy, I know it's important to try and get him on campus as quick as you can.
Well, you know, in Adam's case, he's a young man, a local player who we were very close to a year ago when we were recruiting the 2015 class. And we stayed in contact with him and maintained that relationship over the course of the past year. And when it became apparent that he was ready to leave prep school and ready to enroll at a college in January, we made sure we were front and center. And I think it didn't take very long for Adam to realize that this is the place that he really wanted to be, the place he felt comfortable, the place that he could call home. And now to have him enrolled, have him working with our strength and conditioning staff, have him working with our coaching staff and being around our other players. In the 2 weeks he's been here, we've already seen tremendous improvement, and he's making tremendous strides. And I think it's highly likely that he will impact the game on the field this fall.
Coach, that's a perfect lead into the final question I have with you. You know, so much about the day is about the players that will be here next year, but you've got 70 guys who have been working out since the semester started a couple of weeks ago who are obviously key in bringing this class in, because there's got to be that kind of familiarity and a comfort level as players come in for recruiting visits. But those guys that are already in the program, they've been hard at work for the last couple of weeks.
Well, I can tell you we're very happy and fortunate to have the players that we have. They're the hardest working group of guys that I've ever been around. They really, winning is very, very important to them. But more important than just wanting to win is they're willing to prepare. They're willing to put in the time that's necessary to make themselves better. And if every guy to a man does that, we will become a better football team, and we will have greater success on the field in 2016.
Coach, as always, we appreciate the time coming by and giving us a few minutes here talking about the class. And as I referenced it before, a state of the union. I know you're extremely excited for the 2016 season to get up and going.
We are. We can't wait to get at it.
That is the head coach, Kevin Callahan. What we'll do is take one more timeout. When we return, Eddie will rejoin me at the table, and we'll put a bow on this one and send you on your way from West Long Branch, New Jersey. We're back with more coverage of National Signing Day.
The right education can inspire you to do anything. Challenge yourself. Prepare for success. This is your moment to create, explore, discover, matter to each other and to the world. Be inspired to do anything at Monmouth University.
I first started working with ESPN probably in the fall of this past year.
The production side here has really helped me, because I'm able to put on a resume now that I've tech directed or directed ESPN games.
I want the school to be the best. I want the athletic department to be the best. And we're lucky enough to be blessed with upper administration that believe in that same philosophy.
There is certainly no limit to the coverage that takes place during the course of the day today. You'll have, obviously, continuing signing day coverage on ESPN, ESPN2, ESPNU, the SEC Network, the Longhorn Network as well, and obviously everything that's going on ESPN3 as we get set to kind of wrap up our portion of the day. Eddie, this has been great to obviously be a part of yet again. So much excitement, and I think that's the one word that you can encapsulate this. It's excitement. It's 17 new players, part of a class that hopefully can take Monmouth from where they are right now to where they want to be, and that's obviously one step further along the way, winning a Big South championship.
And we heard the Director of Athletics, Dr. Marilyn McNeil, Matt, say the same thing. The evolution of the program from non-scholarship football through where it is now in the Big South, well, that next step is making the FCS playoffs, the facility upgrades. Obviously, the coaches probably said the same thing to these recruits and their families. They want this group of 17 to be a part of that. And you said it, there's excitement all over the nation today. It's really a new year, and this really begins next football season today. And obviously, like you said, I'm really thankful that we're able to be a part of it. Also thankful we didn't draw that 5 a.m. shift on ESPNU this morning.
No, noon's good, right? You can
noon's
come in,
good.
You can almost have lunch before. We can grab a bite to eat after if we want to. You don't have to wake up too early. We do have to say that our entire crew here today, those in the truck, those out on the floor, those were the ones that had to get up real early to get set up.
We got the best crew in the business, and obviously we're thankful for all they do, the camera people, obviously everyone in the truck. It's a lot of undergrads here at Monmouth University. We're thankful to have that program well underway now, and like you said, they're the ones that have to show up early. We just have to go on camera and talk. We got the best team in the business.
You know, it is fun, obviously, to be part of everything that's going on during the course of the day, and as Coach had said before, this class will probably continue to evolve. You'll see players that will add to it after National Signing Day is over today. It doesn't mean that it's just 17 players, but you do get the feel, like so many programs here on campus, that Monmouth football is on the rise. 3-3 from a season ago in the Big South, another challenging schedule coming here in 2016. But the pieces are there. The steps have been taken. There's a lot of players coming back. You hope that these guys that signed their letters today, they are really the next piece of the puzzle for Monmouth to become a championship contender.
It all starts at the top of this program with Kevin Callahan and his stability, but also, Matt, his ability as a head coach. We've noticed over the years to change with the times. It's amazing how he's always on kind of the forefront of whatever it is, be it schemes on offensive or defensive side of the football, but really things like this and allowing us to come in and do what we do. And you're correct, again, as it continues to evolve and this program continues to take the next steps, it goes kind of hand in with what's happened on campus. Obviously, the great success of the basketball team here at Monmouth this season, but everything else, soccer's incredibly successful, lacrosse as well. And as Marilyn said, that's what that Monmouth Stadium will be. It's not just a football field. It's an overall athletics facility, but just the latest in a long line of improvements. And again, we said it, it's how we began our program, trending upward, and that's where this athletics program and this football team is headed.
And finally, for college football, this is obviously a huge day. So much controversy that surrounds it. Will players change? Will they go to this school or will they go to that school? The one thing that I was so impressed with when I walked in here this morning, all the coaches said, we've got all of our guys, all 17. They made the commitment to Monmouth football. They know they want to be here, and we want to make sure that they're here.
When you see a smiling head coach and recruiting coordinator, you know it was a successful signing day. They had a great day. We had a great day as well.
Yeah, we'll put a wrap on that. 17 new players, 10 from New Jersey. And again, 10 from New Jersey, 4 Maryland, 2 New York, and 1 Pennsylvania. If you want to get more up-to-date information, go to our website at monmouthhawks.com. You can get a full recap of all the signing day effects. Coming up next on ESPN3, you'll have coverage of Northern Illinois and their signing day, Miami of Ohio and their signing day. For all of us here at Monmouth University and my partner Eddie Acapinti, this is Matt Harmon saying so long from West Long Branch, New Jersey. Fax machine, you get the next 364 days off.